This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Look at this magnificent elephant cow very close to us at the moment. Welcome everyone. This is Safari Live.
Ready. Standing by.
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome again to Safari Live. Great to have you with us. Look here, just gonna wait for these elephants to walk past. They're really close. Oh, wow, fantastic. Right past us, incredible. Comes a whole herd. A lot of young ones. There's a little one at the back there. Just keeping my voice down and a bit quiet. Oh, you hear that? Let's just have a look here. There's two coming through the bush here. They just gave off a little vocalization. I don't think they're aggressive at all. They've shown no signs of aggression, but just keeping our voices down a little bit because they are quite close to us. That's fantastic, absolutely amazing. They've walked right around us. See how they're flapping their ears, trying to cool themselves in the heat. It's very, very hot at the moment. So it's 36 degrees Celsius. About 97 degrees Fahrenheit, so really, really hot afternoon. There comes another big female about to walk across in front of us. Wow, she's so close, so close. Vocalization again. This is quite a large herd. There's a number of them. Looks like there's probably about 15 or so, 15 to 20 elephants around here. Lovely size herd. What a great way to start. Oh, could you hear that? Could you hear that vocalization? Hear them communicating. They give off this low frequency vocalization, and that's how the herd communicates with each other. Right behind us, they've walked right around us, all around us. It's incredible. Comes another really large one behind, towards the back. We'll see him shortly. And this is a male. It's approaching towards the back of the herd. Younger male. Let's just watch him carefully and just see how he reacts to us. The rest of the herd's been completely relaxed. And he looks okay too. And occasionally these males do try to show us that they are a bit more dominant and that we shouldn't get in their way. But very relaxed, not worried about us at all. Isn't that amazing? Afternoon again, everyone. My name is Byron, and on camera with me this afternoon, I have Viam. Hi, Viam. And then we've got Taylor and David on the other vehicle. And a wonderful afternoon to the ladies in the FC. We've got Kirsten and Lou this afternoon. It's great to have you with us on our Safari Live drive, our Sunset drive, and what a great start. Don't forget to please send us your questions at hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or otherwise email us with questions at wildearth.tv and we'll hopefully answer them for you. What a great start. That is fantastic. Look how they're reaching up into the trees trying to get those leaves. And just as quickly as they appeared, they've moved right through and right past us. And that is really, really great. What a wonderful start. Myself and Viem are heading to Cheetah Plains this afternoon, somewhere different. I haven't been down here for quite some time. And we're just going to have a look at some of the water holes and see what activity is around there. It is very warm, so I'm hoping that we have some luck with some animals close to the water. While I'm heading towards Cheetah Plains, Taylor would like to say good afternoon to you.
I would indeed like to say good afternoon to everyone. Welcome to, again, another sweltering afternoon sunrise safari. We are day three in the scorching heat, and my name is Taylor, and of course on camera we this afternoon, David has made a return after his rest. How do you feel after your rest, David? He feels very rested, that's very good. I'm sure he wasn't looking forward to being baked into the sun, but I love this weather, as hot as what it is. It means we're hopefully going to find things at the watering hole. Should we go down this way, or should we go straight? We'll go straight ahead then. We're going to go and check watering holes for the first little bit of the show. I think that everybody is going to be dying of thirst. So we're on our way down to the southern end of the property, and then of course we're most certainly going to follow up on the Nkuhumas, who gave us a spectacular show this morning. And hopefully they've all joined up again, I believe, and hopefully they've finished that buffalo carcass that was on Torchwood, and then we'll be able to go back onto Duma again, and I'm sure that they're going to go for that big bull that unfortunately died as well. So that's going to be the plan for today. But first, animal number one seems like it's going to be a zebra. Let's see. Oh, it's a lovely herd of them. Hello, zebra. Let's see if we can sneak up just a little bit closer to get a little bit of a better view. There we go. And of course, we've got their rumps, and one is snorting at us. And I think that their next move is going to be to head towards the dam. Their feet don't look particularly dirty. It doesn't look like they've stood in any mud just yet. No. So that'll be a definite indication to see if the animals have gone to have a drink or not, is to see how muddy their feet are. Because the pans are all starting to dry up now, they're having to come right into the middle of the dams or the natural pans and battle through all the clay mud to the center where the last little bits of water are. Oh, they're going to get very dirty in the process. And something else we're hoping to see this afternoon is some elephants splashing around. Now, we did pass a group of elephants, but they were moving through a very thick block, so it'll be something that we will follow up on in a little while. And perhaps they'll take us back to Chele Pan, which, like I always say, is one of the best spots to find the elephants. I thought that their tails would have been working overtime today with the heat that normally brings insects, but perhaps it's even too hot for the flies. There seems to just be minimal use of the tails. Isn't this a fantastic way to start the day? It is very hot, in case you missed it. I'm not sure if Byron told you what the temperature was, but it's about 96 degrees Fahrenheit, so a little bit hotter than what it was yesterday, and there are no clouds in the sky. Or very few, very small ones. It's getting hazy and the wind has picked up since this morning, which is good because they have forecasted rain. Whether we get it, I'm not sure. We obviously all hope so. Perhaps this is going to be an evening indeed for a rain dance. David, how do you feel about that?
Oh, I'm not convinced.
David's not convinced, but perhaps I shall do one a little bit later and jump around and do all sorts of crazy things. and hopefully that will bring down the rain. If it means rain, I'll really do anything. That's lovely. But let's carry on. Let's head down towards the dam. We're not too far. I want to have a very quick look to perhaps see if there are any impala or anything really that's lurking down there. Perhaps the hippo from yesterday is down also in the drying up pools of water. We're starting to see lots of hippo bulls again popping up at all the watering features. Well, impala are here. Yeah, they are just around the corner. Let's see if we can get these males that are just here. There they go. And of course, this is how you normally see them when you see impala with me, is dashing off into the distance. Seems like just the boys are here. I didn't see any females, but I'm sure that will change once everyone starts coming down for a little drink. Oh, there was a little mongoose that ran around. Oh, there's a couple of them. Well, they've all run away, hiding under the logs. There you go. There's one disappearing into the distance and up into the termite mound. I don't know if I'd be out today. I think the termite mound would be a little bit of a cooler place. No, I can't see any more mongoose. They've all gone. Well, we're almost here. Let's just head a little bit further forward. A whole family of warthogs. Hi, warthogs. Oh, there's so many. No, we can't look at the warthogs. Sorry. There's a warthog running into the distance. You can see. Sorry. They're glistening on the back from all the mud that it was rolling around in. And they've gone in a dash. With the wind, I think we're going to see a little bit of jumpiness. Especially with the impala, with the warthogs, with the giraffe, and all those wonderful creatures. Remember, it affects their hearing and their sense of smell a little bit. Right, but let's carry on. It doesn't seem like there's really anything of interest in the watering hole for us, just those warthogs that were there. Okay, but we'll carry on. Right, let's go across to Byron, who has finally reached his destination.
See, Taylor's got the same idea as me as checking some of the water holes. It is very, very warm this afternoon. We're on Cheetah Plains at the moment and just having a look around here to see if there's any water in this dam. Nope, I'll show you now, but it's completely dry, this little dam. Let's see if VM can have a look there for you. Now, see that? Just hard caked mud. No water in here, but there are some other water holes around this area which they do pump water to, and we're heading to those at the moment. Oh, hang on, VM spotted something over there. Let's have a look here quickly. Oh, let me jump off, let's see. Okay, let's have a look here. Excuse me a second, unplug. Where about did you see it? Yeah?
There, right next to your foot.
There we go. Oh, well spotted. Okay, so VM is correct, 100% correct. There's a leopard track just over here. I don't know if you can see where I'm pointing, if we're a little bit close. The only thing I'm worried about is I don't see another track afterwards. There have been vehicles that have driven across this road, so it could be from this morning sometime. Let's just have a good look carefully along here. We're past some buffalo earlier, so we have to keep watching out the whole time when you are tracking, just in case there's something else around and not necessarily the animal that you're looking for. Unfortunately, I don't see any other tracks. I think, and there have been some impala tracks along here, buffalo tracks. It's just that one leopard track, but it's headed in this direction. I can see the vehicle tracks, so possibly driven over from this morning. So well spotted though, VMG. But I do think that this was from sometime this morning. That's exciting though. First leopard track we've seen in a while. We are definitely, I'm just trying to get all these wires again. We are definitely trying to find a leopard for you, especially this afternoon. So that's a good start though. It's a really good start. At least if we see that there are tracks around, we know that there's leopard activity. And the chances of then hopefully finding one are a lot better. I'm going to continue towards one of the water holes. Sounds like Taylor's pigs have returned.
Yes, they have, and I'm so happy that we managed to catch them again. They are such beautiful creatures. And this seems to be a family of sows, so just the mothers, yeah, just the females, and they've all got beautiful big bellies. Can you see that? Which is very exciting. That means little piglets. Oh, there's a male, one male, and of course two big sows in front. The one in front is rather large. She's got big tusks on her for being a female. And it's quite typical to see them around the watering holes and natural pans in the heat of the day, very much like rhino, like buffalo and hippos. They of course enjoy wallowing in the mud. I think we're actually going to get another sight of them. They might pop out just in front of us. Let's have a look, see. There they are. Dried off very quickly. In this heat though, everything seems to be evaporating. Now they've got a relatively long gestation period of about 5.5 months or so. I'm not sure when their prime mating season is. I didn't see any warthogs mating this year, which makes it quite difficult to figure out when they are going to give birth. But when they do, they should have anywhere between 5 and about 6 piglets, but unfortunately not all of them are going to survive. Like I said, they make tasty snacks for leopards, for lions, and for all of the different predators, which is very sad for the warthogs. But I suppose it's a good thing as well, because as wonderful as warthogs are, some people actually find them to be pests. We don't find them to be pests, but farmers in the local areas could perhaps, they'll decimate entire grasslands in a very, very short period of time. So they, unfortunately, are not loved by everybody. But we try and keep them safe. And they're very good diggers. They often dig underneath the beautiful big game fences we have, which we try and keep those there to keep them safe. But they don't realize this. Let's see if we can get one last look. They're trotting off now, but I think we could catch them. There they are. Yeah, lovely clear view of them crossing the road, and off always when they start off running in a bit of a dash, the tail goes straight up into the air. But you can see this old girl at the back. She's not particularly worried at all. I think she's been around for a good few years. They can live for quite a long time, almost up to about 17 years. And off they go into the thicket. It was fantastic. I think we're gonna have a good afternoon. It's been a good start so far. But we'll leave those warthogs to carry on with their day, perhaps wherever they're heading next, maybe to get their nails done, get that mane tinted again. I'm not sure what warthogs do in their spare time when they're not eating and rolling around in mud and using the luxury facilities. But I know what we're going to be doing. David has suggested that we go and check Sydney's dam out. And that's what we'll be doing. Now, Of course, this morning was a bit of a graveyard show in the sense of how many dead buffalo we had, which is very unfortunate because it was definitely a sign of the drought. I know that Debbie from Vancouver was wondering exactly the same thing, if we could perhaps go and have a look at all those carcasses. I'd love to. I think we're going to do a big loop though. It's extremely hot. So I think that if those lions were to have moved, I don't know if they're going to have moved yet off from their buffalo kill that they had earlier, the little one. So after we've done Sydney's Dam, we're definitely going to go back and check the whole carcass, the second dead buffalo that we found. We're going to go over there and have a look. And then, well, we'll just have to wait and hopefully catch the right moment that they cross back into our traverse. Now I'm just having a scan. I can't believe as quick as the bush greened up and thickened up, it almost looks like it's disappearing again. Don't you think, David? It's looking very dry all of a sudden. Sure, and that's amazing how quickly that happened. Well, it's getting pretty windy here, so hopefully that's going to bring the clouds in. But let's go back across to Byron and see how he's going and how those leopard tracks are doing.
No, those leopard tracks were definitely from this morning sometime, so not worth trying to follow now. But we have found some buffalo. We've got a herd of buffalo. We're not too far from a waterhole. I wonder if they've had a drink already. I'm going to carry on. The waterhole is not far up ahead. And we'll see. You can hear these buffalo moving through the thicket line. And as Taylor said, the wind has just picked up recently. And I can hear one of the red-crested korans we spoke about it this morning. I'll see if we can find it. I'm going to just carry on. Let's head up to this waterhole. It's just up the road here. And hopefully we have something drinking. A lot of antelope around here at the moment. There's some impala moving through the thickets. Just away from the water, there's some kudu that I just saw move off. So let's see what else there is. And I wonder how much water is here actually. Like I said, I haven't been here for a long time. But I do know they pump water to this specific waterhole, but it's not very full at the moment. Just reposition, gonna park in the shade a little bit here. Egyptian geese. There we go. So Viam and I don't cook completely in the heat. And yeah, so we've got a few water birds around. The Egyptian geese, there they go. They're actually really beautiful geese. But they are found all over South Africa. And especially around waterholes. You can hear some blacksmith lapwings calling in the distance. Just behind us in the bush. Maybe they come round towards the water a bit later. As I said, the kudu and that have run off, the impala. We just got a question from Brian. Good afternoon to you, Brian. And Brian has asked us, how many vehicles would typically move through an area like this for an afternoon game drive or during the day? There we go. There's the blacksmith lapwing. Oh, see where it lands. Beautiful sound as it flies. It sounds almost like a blacksmith hitting away at a piece of metal. And that's where I think it gets its name, the blacksmith lapwing or blacksmith plover. Brian, getting back to your question, it all depends on the areas. So for example, where we are situated in what is known as the Greater Kruger National Park, and we up in the Sabi Sands, which is a private area, so only the lodges that are around here are able to go have vehicles on the land and on the property. There are traversing rights around here too, depending on which properties have those agreements. So it all depends on the size of the lodges. Some lodges maybe have three or four vehicles for smaller lodges. Other lodges that are a bit larger may have up to 12 or 14 vehicles. Those lodges probably have a greater area. I know in this area there are a number of different properties around. There are traversing rights available or traversing agreements, and you could have between 5 and 15 vehicles moving on an area of about 12,000 hectares, 10 to 12,000 hectares. In some areas I know there are about 12 or 14 vehicles in about 16,000 hectares. So they try and spread it out as much as possible. But again, it depends on the area and it depends on the traversing. Whereas in the national parks, obviously that's open to the public and you can have a lot more vehicles, but there the rules are different. They cannot off-road like we can. They cannot track and follow the animals. So it is very different. They have to stick to the main roads. So completely different to these private areas where we are operating. All right. Don't see much else happening here at the moment. Hang on, something interesting. Viam, if we can have a look off to the water's edge, I'd just like to show you some butterflies. Oh, look at that, beautiful. Beautiful yellow coloration. Hard now with the sun hitting them, and we'll see if we can actually get a little bit closer. But I think those are brown veined whites or common vagrants. Let's just have a look. Let's see if I can get a little bit closer. Even though they look like they've got a yellowish coloration. See if we can see the very prominent brown veins on their wings, if it is those that I'm thinking of. Where are they now? Can you see them there, Viam, from your height? There we go. Okay, no, these are not the brown-veined whites. I saw one fly off to the left there. These are different. And I think these might be the common vagrants, if I'm not mistaken. If there are any butterfly experts watching, they can shed some light on it, but I'm almost certain that these are common vagrants. Just having a good look with my binoculars. Sometimes these little butterflies do look quite similar, but there's certain butterfly species that you do see regularly in the area, and especially little groups like this around water. So it's nice, it looks like they've come down to drink. There are quite a few other ones around here, but that red-crested coron calling in the distance again. I don't seem to see it. There's another one that's just sat down there. Looks like they're all the same species, these butterflies, at the moment. Oh, that's wonderful, something different. Nice to see butterflies. But I must admit, some of them are quite difficult to identify or actually just remember all the various names. When you get these beautiful broad-bordered grass yellows, they're little yellow butterflies like this that you see along the roads often. But the names are tongue twisters, aren't they? I'm going to continue wandering through Cheetah Plains, checking some of the other water holes and see if we don't have animals coming down to drink. Perhaps we just missed those buffalo moving off, so they may have had a drink a bit earlier. And while I continue, let's get an update from Taylor.
So we're slowly making our way towards Sydney Dam, and while we've been doing so, David and I have had a little bet. I asked him, what animal does he think we're going to see next? His answer is elephants, or an elephant, and mine is kudu. I don't know why I said could you, but it just popped into my head, so we'll go with that one and we'll see who's right. Now I'm of course looking very carefully to find that could you, even if it's 600 meters away. David's also looking away trying to find the big gray elephant. Not that there's a reward or anything, it's who wins, it's just sort of to keep us entertained as we go along. But I'd like to hear from you, what animal do you think we're going to see next? You've got to be quick though, because I can already see it, so I'm going to have to ruin it. David, we're both wrong. It's impala. Should have gone with the old impala. When in doubt, that's the animal that's always going to be around. Sorry, I did park on a slight incline. There you go, you can see the impala walking away now. So we were both wrong, but we've both come out of this experience learning lots, haven't we?
Oh, yeah.
And off they go into the shade, and that's exactly where I'd be if I was an animal. I think I would have taken a break from eating and just sort of rest up in the shade, but then I probably wouldn't be a very successful animal. It's something that they have to continue doing all the time, is eating. And there they are. What? Let's carry on though. Now again, I'm going to try my luck. Even though it's been about 3 days now, we have been trying to find a cuckoo and get it on screen. So that challenge is still there. Perhaps today will be the day. I haven't heard any just yet. Oh, more pigs. It's going to be a warthog day. There they are. Hello, warthogs. Oh my goodness, did you hear that horrendous call in the distance? It was the scream of a very angry elephant. You can see two warthogs there. It looks like possibly mom and a juvenile, which is unusual. Maybe it was from last year and it's just slightly dwarfed in size. But normally when warthogs get to about a year old, they're almost completely adult size. But the two of them are very happily feeding in the shade. They are basically chasing the shade, very much how we are chasing the watering holes today. And we always chat about how sort of well and effective the different colorations are on animals for camouflage and all those amazing things. And one of the most successful sort of adaptions to try and evade a predator or put off a predator are those long whisker-like tufts of hair off the side of the warthog's face. Can you see that? Now it may not look like much now, but you can see when you get a little bit of light catching it, it sort of shines quite white, so lighter hair compared to the rest of their body. And from a distance, when a warthog is looking face on to its predator or to whatever has given it a fright, those look like massive tusks protruding from the face. And the first time I heard this when I was very young, I thought that that was preposterous. Until I saw it, and I can still remember when I was a young girl looking, I think I even shouted out, "Wow, that warthog's got big tusks." And to my dad's response, he was basically like, he laughed and he said, "I told you that the hair looks like tusks," because I never wanted to believe him. I was always reluctant to believe my dad's stories. He often used to tell all sorts of fibs. And then I would repeat them because I was such a trusting girl and everyone would laugh at me. So sometimes I didn't take his words, but I can indeed agree with my dad now. Having a lovely munch. Now you can really see how dry the ground is. Not even able to stay in one spot and eat the grass. Not even bothering going down on the knees because the distances between the patches of grass are getting larger and larger now. No table manners, of course, like Jamie says, and I love that line. There is no such thing as table manners out here. Everybody chews with their mouth open. Nobody wipes their face when they've got a bit of mud or anything on it. They leave it there. Which I think is quite funny. Something that we also might start to see with the vegetation drying up again and, well, the rain, we're not sure when it's going to come, is perhaps to start seeing the warthogs coming closer and closer into camp. which is going to be quite exciting when you come around the corner and there'll be a big warthog boar there. They sort of become almost very relaxed with people when they are desperate for food. And not to say that we're going to feed them, but they just start to come closer to the human habitations where you find things like watered and manicured gardens. And they, instead of running away like they normally would, they tend to hang around for a little bit longer. But not to be fooled though. Never get too close. Jamie, hello. How are you doing today? Oh, I'm going to just say I'd had my foot on the brake for some very naughty reason. Now, Jamie, you want to know how many teeth do warthogs have? I have absolutely no idea. I can see, though, that they've got two in the form of tusks. And the rest, well, I haven't actually had a count. Now, I know we've got some perfectly good warthog skulls in the tent, so I'll have to head in there this evening and count them. And then, Jamie, I'll have to get back to you a little bit later. I apologize for that. I can't even begin to imagine how many teeth they would have. I know they have molars, though, which they'll use to grind up all the grass and whatever else they manage to eat. All that marula fruit that we should start seeing at the beginning of next year. Very crusty from all the mud. It's really lovely just to sometimes sit and have a listen to what's going on. Yeah, the one at the back is now down on its knees having a little munch. But we're going to carry on, I'm afraid, to head towards Sydney's dam. And while I do that, let's go to Byron, who's got plenty and plenty of buffalo around him.
We have got plenty of buffalo, and a few of them have just got out of this little water hole or mud wallow. But look at that, caked in mud, that big bull. And they do that to cool themselves down and protect their skin from all the flies and the insects, and they love to wallow around in the mud. There's one, actually, you can just see the horn sticking out just to the right of that one. That's, there we go. Completely submerged in the mud. Must actually be quite nice lying in there. I'm a little bit jealous. Let's see what that other one does. Seems to be scratching a little bit on the sand. So Taylor has asked us a question, and I hope it's not Taylor on the other vehicle. Taylor's asked us if these man-made water holes have any environmental effect. And Taylor, I think we need to remember that over the years, 100 years ago when man first arrived in this area and we took over managing these game reserves, there was natural water and no fences, and animals could move where they wanted to. What has happened over the years is obviously fences have been put up because of the increase in the population and people around these game reserves. So to protect the people and to protect the animals and the conservation areas. So the animals are unable to move around as much to find water like they used to. So we need to have these unnatural water holes, which we pump water to provide water for a lot of the animals. But that debate has been going on for many, many, many years. I do think it does play a little role in the movement of the animals and also the effect of the vegetation around the water holes. You can see it's quite bare in this immediate area, and it's possibly because of an increase in animal density around the water holes, so not a lot of vegetation is able to grow. But again, we need to remember the animals aren't able to move around as much as they used to go and find food and water. So it's a tricky subject, but management is definitely needed. But I do think it does affect certain areas to an extent, but if it's managed correctly, it's not an issue, if that makes sense. So I hope that answers your question, Taylor, but a very good question, because that is a debate that a lot of conservationists have had for many, many years. The wind is definitely picking up now quite a bit. I'm sure you can see or hear, which is interesting. So that could mean that it's bringing bad weather. So we will see, we will see. Hopefully we get some rain after drive, though, not during game drive. And I know Taylor said she was going to do a rain dance, so we shall see. And I know she also wanted to see a cuckoo. And we actually got to see a cuckoo just off air. Very beautiful cuckoo. It was an African cuckoo, and that's not one that we see very regularly. So that was nice. We caught a quick glimpse of it and flew off again. And I know we've been trying to show you a cuckoo for a while. There are a number of cuckoo species, so we'll hopefully find some for you over the next few days and going into summer. Jimmy has asked us a question about the drought, and has it affected us quite badly because it's moving into the rainy season? So Jimmy, well, this drought has been particularly bad this year. This has been really, really bad. A lot of the water holes and rivers have dried up, which some I've never seen dry before. But because of this long or extended dry period, it has been very bad. And it has definitely affected a lot of the animals. We've seen, and some of the results of this drought we saw this morning, all these buffalo that are being hunted by the lions because they're just not as powerful as they would be when they have a lot of food around. And a lot of the buffalo are looking quite thin and struggling a little bit. So a lot of herbivores, because there's not a lot of food, they have been struggling during the dry season and the drought. But it's starting to become green. We're starting to see green grass shoots popping up and a lot more vegetation flowering and just flourishing a little bit. So hopefully with the little bit of rain, we're getting bits and pieces here and there. As soon as we start getting our regular storms, I think everything's going to be rejuvenated and it should sort out this area very quickly and get all the vegetation back. We need to remember, though, that I think, and I always say, this is nature's way of maintaining a balance, a natural balance of wildlife, which is important. If the numbers continue to flourish and animals continue to increase, it will devastate entire areas and there won't be any vegetation left. So this is nature's way, I think, of maintaining a balance. The weaker, older animals will die during the drought because there's no food, and only the stronger genes will then make it through to the next season to be able to breed and then populate the population. Let us continue. We're going to head down towards the plains here on Cheetah Plains and see if there's anything interesting wandering around there. I know the other day Taylor had some luck with cheetah. So, who knows? Maybe we get lucky with some cheetah this afternoon. And Taylor is just having a field day with all the warthogs. She's got some more to show you.
And I really do hope that you do indeed find some cheetah on Cheetah Plains. That would be fitting. And of course, we are having a warthog kind of day, which is quite nice. I don't think that anybody would be disappointed in a warthog day, seeing as though they are rather difficult to capture on camera. We have definitely had all the luck in the world, which is lovely. I'm loving this. It started off earlier today when we went to test Wendy. We took Wendy on a little drive to see how she's doing, and she seems to be doing very well, which is exciting news in case you were worried and having sleepless nights because you don't know what happened to Wendy. Wendy is one of our vehicles, if you've just started watching. And then we tried to watch a warthog in the wallow, in a mud wallow, sorry, with Kirsty and Rebecca, but it did not want to do so, which is very, very frustrating. And now, of course, they are doing the best that they absolutely can. Look at this. A little bit hot, even they are breathing quite quickly. And I'm sure that you can hear that the wind is now picked up quite substantially. That's a good spot though, hiding in the shade. But let's carry on. Let's go around to Sydney's Dam. We're not far now. We're about to head past Gowrie Gate, so the most northern entrance into the Sabi Sands, which is the wilderness area that we're in. And of course, we've got Herbie up again. We have to say hello to Herbert though and see how his exam went. Hi Herbie! Here's Herbert. Now Herbert, a lot of the viewers sent in sort of requests and comments and wishing you well on your exams. How was it?
Oh, it was good.
There we go. Herbie says it wasn't too bad, and I'm sure he passed with absolute flying colors, and I'm sure you missed that smile as well. But let's carry on. Herbert's going to help us try and find a leopard this afternoon because Byron and I seem to not be very good at it, apparently. Bye, Herbie.
Bye.
See you later. Which is quite funny, but now that Herbie's back in business, I'm sure we're going to be successful over the next few days. But let's quickly try and get it to this dam. I really hope that there are some elephants there. That would be quite nice. Or even a hippo, maybe some buffalo wallowing, a few birds. That would be good. Now we're going past some of the houses that the staff stays in. We're just going to get past them now, and then we will have Sydney's Dam on our left. So we're coming around the corner, we're not to then. I know we've got a couple of questions about why the lions don't get into the lodge. Now, they actually do. Oh, can we go here? We can go here, hey. I always forget that we can come down here. And sorry, Kirst, I didn't quite get the name there. Lyot. Is it? Lyot, sorry. And you were wondering why is it that they can't get into the lodge? I'd actually be surprised they could. That electric fence, most of the lodges have electric fences around them, but unfortunately that doesn't always work, and sometimes they will come through. Normally it's a bit of a concern, sorry, to keep the buffalo and the elephants out. And of course the antelope, well, it's quite difficult because if it's a low fence they'll just jump over. So where I used to work, I used to bump into the lions on a regular basis taking guests back to their rooms, which was always quite fun and quite interesting. You can see this lovely Nyala bull just starting to get his little horns now, and he's very relaxed with us. That's quite impressive. Normally they will dart across the road if they seem to be far away from its mother, but perhaps mom is just nearby and already moved off and into the bushes. Isn't that lovely? Now we're going to try and get a view of Sydney's Dam, but from what I've seen, I think I could have seen a buffalo. It also could have been a rock or a log or an elephant. I didn't have a proper look. A quick glimpse, so we'll see if we can get a view up here. David, do you think we're going to get a better view?
Yeah.
Right. There we go. Up and over the top. Just basically heading to higher ground. We're a bit almost below the dam at the moment. Right, up we go. Now we need to just find a nice gap to look back in. Still up ahead?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to put my foot down on the pedal and push it a little bit harder. Oh, here's the gaps. Okay, there we go. How's that? Can we go closer? My goodness, I keep forgetting, and I think I keep doing this with David every single time, as I think that we can only drive in certain spots, but I can actually head further. I'm always edging on the side of caution though, just in case. Oh, I can see some buffalo. Let's see if we can get a gap. Back a little bit, hey? There, is that good?
Yep.
It's very far away. Now the wind is howling. You can see them in the far corner having a little cool down, keeping out of the wind. Just having a grand old time. That one's using the luxury restrooms, as you can see. It looks like it's a bull. And if I was a buffalo, that's exactly where I'd be. I think this is the first time I've actually seen any life at Sydney's dam. It's always been so quiet, except for the odd blacksmith lapwing. But they're almost a given at any of the watering sites. But let's carry on. It doesn't seem like our watering hole search is going very well. We've got one more to check. We want to check Biffle's Hook Dam as well. And after we've checked that, well, then we're closer and closer to the destination where we last left the lions. So that is our end goal, of course. And let's not waste any more time. Just sort of checking the perimeters today as well. Right. Let's go down here. Now we have got this long stretch of road ahead of us. I think we're going to see some elephants along this way. I just have a good feeling about that, which would be nice. Right. We're going to slowly start making our way to Biffle's Hook Dam. And while we tackle the long journey ahead, let's go to Byron, who's finally reached the big open plain.
I have indeed reached the plains, Taylor, but, oh, hang on, just two little sternbok running off in front of us. Let's see if we can find them for you. They're usually in pairs, the little sternbok. Beautiful little antelope. There's a bird that just took off there too, bird of prey. Oh, some of these, when they move too quickly, it's hard to identify these birds of prey as they're flying away from you. It looked like a Wahlberg's eagle, though. And I don't see it, but I'm almost certain it was a Wahlberg's eagle. There's two little sternbok just ran off, and they seem to have disappeared. They are very shy, usually. Quite skittish little antelope. You can imagine being so small, they've got to be very careful, and they're very alert, so they tend to move away from any potential danger. So we did go through the plains on Cheetah Plains, and unfortunately we didn't come across any predators. There was a lot of general game around. There was a lot of impala. We saw some giraffe in the distance, and it was a little bit far, quite far south of our boundary. And a few animals dotted around. So now we're right up very close to the Kruger National Park boundary, which is off to our east. And just seeing what we find along here. So Kelly has sent through a comment, and Kelly would love to see an aardvark and an ostrich. Well, Kelly, I'm not sure when last they saw aardvark in this area. We do get them in the Sabi Sands. There definitely are aardvark around. I've seen tracks of them. I've never seen one in the Sabi Sands though. The only two that I ever saw, the one was being eaten by lions. They had killed it during the evening. And the other one had been caught by a leopard and had actually been hoisted into the tree. But they're very, very shy. And out here, I think when it's so hot, the aardvark don't really enjoy the heat as much. So they come out really late at night. Very shy nocturnal animals. Another part of the country in the Kalahari. I've been there a number of times and I've had a lot of luck with seeing aardvark out there. They, because the temperatures in that area, especially in winter, get very, very cold. And the aardvark come out a lot earlier in the afternoons, and if you're lucky, you get to see them at 4 or 5 o'clock in the afternoon wandering around looking for food. Ostriches, we do have ostriches around, and if I'm not mistaken, I think I saw a few on Cheetah Plains in June when I was last year. I think there were a few ostriches around. I know down in the southern part of the Sabi Sands there have been some ostriches. So there are ostriches around, just haven't seen for a while, but who knows, they could come through at any stage. I think our chances of seeing an ostrich are a lot better than seeing an aardvark. still very, very hot this afternoon, so I think maybe that's why we're not getting as much activity, animals moving around. Probably all still hidden in the shade somewhere. Or those that have passed through to the water holes and have moved on again into the thickets. Oh, here we go. Some beautiful birds to show you. Let's see if they land. They're flying around here. European bee eaters. Let's see, there goes another one. That's a bit tricky. We're going to really make VM work for his supper tonight. There we go. Look at that. European bee eaters. Now, these are also migratory birds, and they arrive back here in the summer. And a lot of them have just returned. Well, they've actually been here for a while. I remember hearing some about a few weeks ago. Flying all over the place. Hopefully one or two perch for us and you can have a look at them. They've got beautiful colors. Let me see if I can quickly find them in the book just to show you the coloration. There's one VM just behind us on that very thin branch of that larger tree sticking out over there. The glare at the moment, but there you can see it. European bee eater. That's nice, and usually you hear them flying around, but to see them is quite difficult. Look at that long, sharp beak, and they will catch insects while they are flying around. So now often they do something known as hawking, and what it is these bee eaters, they take off from a perch like that, and they'll do a little loop around where they then, just in front of us, quickly just on the second little branch. Oh, there it goes. It was just a little better view. It might come back. There we go, on the edge of that tree, look at that. And that one caught an insect, did you see that? So what they do is they fly around, and as they're flying, they'll catch an insect on the wing, as we call it, and then they'll go and perch and eat it. And this hawking is often, what they do is they'll fly, do a little loop, and return to the same perch. You can see how windy it is. Bird keeping its balance in those branches which are waving about in the wind. Look at that. That's wonderful. This is so great. I love seeing these birds that you usually hear a lot, but you don't often see them perching. So it's nice for us to be able to show them to you. Look at that, being bounced around. Surprised it hasn't taken off yet. All right, let me just try to show you a little picture in my bird book over here so you can see the beautiful colors of the European bee eater, and that is it, that one over there. And just look at all the colors, this bluish turquoise underneath, yellow, rufous or chestnut on the back. Beautiful colors. All of the bee eaters are very, very colorful. And it's lovely to see. You can see that's a whole page on bee eaters. Another really lovely one is this one at the bottom, the Southern Carmine bee eater. And again, these books don't do them any justice because they are bright, almost pinkish red. Really amazing, amazing color. But that was great. Lovely to see these birds flying around. Let's see what else we can find. I'm going to continue searching these plains, and while I do that, Taylor's got something different that she'd like to show you.
Managed to get a kudu bull. Yesterday afternoon I was absolutely itching to try and find a kudu bull that would stand well for hours, but we got him. And I think at the moment he's pretending that he is a tree. He has not moved once until, as I said that, of course. Very concerned about all the little birds chatting away all of a sudden, so he's listening quite carefully. Listen to this, turn your volume up.
Looks like Taylor's got some gremlins around her vehicle. That's all right. We're still searching the plains. Moving into some thicker bush now. Hopefully we get something wandering around through here. So keeping my eye out for little animals that might be hiding in the shade of these trees. Can hear some cicadas around here. It's definitely a sign of summer. These cicada bugs calling. It's an amazing sound. All these little pans, and there's one off to our right, completely dry. So this is a natural pan, but as soon as we get some rainfall, and you'll see there, you can see no water at all, but as soon as we start getting a bit of rainfall, this will fill up and you'll have some more water around. It'll become very, very lush. And you'll look in the trees for any birds. And I also have absolutely no idea where we are at the moment, other than that, the fact that we're on Cheetah Plains. This area I haven't been to before, which is nice, so I'm exploring a little bit. So it is very dry and barren here. There's no grass at all. We've got a question from James. I think I'm struggling to copy Kirsten a little bit. Sounds like James Duncan. And James would like to know if I did any animal viewing when I was in the States. So I've recently returned from a trip to New York. Did some marketing over there for our business, and it was, what a wonderful trip. I really enjoyed New York because it was so different and really not something that I'm used to at all, and definitely a different kind of jungle. I could not believe how many people there were, just all over, littered in the streets until all hours of the morning. So it was an incredible experience for me. So I think different animals, not quite the animals that I'm used to, but it was a lot of fun, and we met so many wonderful people and had a great time with the guests of ours and their friends and people that are going to be coming on safari with us in the future. So it was really, really wonderful. As I was saying, I could just see there's literally no grass at all through these areas that we are driving. There's little shoots popping up at the moment, but all these areas, these plains, completely dry or barren, and that's because of the bad drought. But it'll be good to see it recover again. Flies around. Sounds like Taylor's managed to beat off the gremlin. She's got signal back. Let's get an update from her.
Well, hello apologize for that. I'm not sure what you heard me saying, but I think I was saying something along the lines of, if you could hear the bird that was calling in the distance, I'm not sure whether you could have before I got cut off by those silly gremlins. I was listening to a pearl-spotted owlet that was calling quite close by. But never mind. And then I was going to ask you if you, any of you could guess it, of course. But now that I've given you the answer, it's no need to worry. We're just having a little look here to see if there's anything at Biffleswick Dam. Nothing that I think you would find particularly interesting. It's very dry. Very, very, very dry. Now, seeing as though there's nothing around that is really too fantastic, not even any birds, even the lapwings have moved on to try and escape the heat of the day. And we're going to head back now to that second carcass that the lions found today. Well, it was alive when we found him, and I'm sure that by now, unfortunately, he would have passed on. But I wonder if there's going to be any vultures there, or perhaps even better, some lions, or both. That would be quite nice. So that is what we need to do. But before we do that, we've got a zebra crossing up ahead. Hi, zebbies. They're watching us very carefully, as you can see. And you can also... Right. Let's very quickly go across to Byron, though, because he's got a very special antelope.
I do indeed have a special antelope. This is fantastic. We were driving and saw a group of impala and saw this antelope, which looked a little different. And on closer inspection, this is a reedbuck. That's amazing. Oh, there it goes. Come on, come out into the open for us. Just hang on. Just moving a little bit. Let me just move forward for us. Oh, that is great. You don't see them very often around here. So that was a really, really great surprise. Hang on, I'm just going to try and get us through this gap over here. Can you see it there, Valdi? A little bit off to the right, I think. No, there's an impala. Oh, you know what? There it is. Hang on. Have a look through there, maybe. Straight through the gap. No, this is very tricky. It's quite thick through here. Love to show you this antelope. This is not one that, as I said, not one that we see often. It is still there. I can just see it moving. Hang on a second. We'll get it for you now. Let me just try to reverse a little bit more here. You can see its head sticking out there. There we go. So straight through these two trees, through the back there. I think I'm right a little bit more, just right to that... There we go. Now it just came out. Look at that. There, we got it for you. A reedbuck. Fantastic. This is really great. I've not seen a reedbuck. Are there two of them? A male and female. Very uniform brown coloration. Not too many markings. Just a little bit of white on the belly. Very different. Shall I see if I can show you? Yeah, and Monique from London has just sent us a comment and said, wow, she's never seen a reedbuck before. And I wonder how many of our viewers have seen reedbuck here. Because I know we really don't see them in these areas very often. So it's wonderful to see them, especially here. They tend to prefer open grassland, long grass. Look at that. Oh, that's the male. Wonderful. This is very exciting. It's always nice to see new species or species that we don't see often. So James has just asked us, what is the social structure of the reedback like? So James, I've seen them in small herds, never really large groups like the impala, much smaller herds, occasionally in pairs or sometimes solitary. Just trying to see if I can find one for you. Yeah, there's impala walking through the background there. This is really wonderful. And James, also with the social structure, almost similar in terms of the impala, where the one male may have anywhere between 2 and 6 ewes. A ram will have a number of ewes or females, but not very large herds, not large groups at all. Look at that. That's amazing. We also have mountain reedback, and they look very similar, but these, I think, are the common reedback. They do look very similar, but based on the area that we're in and the distribution and that, these are the common reedback. Just really wonderful to see them. Monique in London again would like to know, are these reedback bigger than a steenbok? Yes, Monique, they are much larger than steenbok. They're almost the same size as an impala, just to give you an idea. So when those impala walked past earlier, they're fairly, I wouldn't say large antelope, but medium size. They're not as small as a steenbok or a duiker. They're much larger than that. So about the size of an impala. Yeah, so that was wonderful. What a nice surprise. I just read quickly that there have been some records of groups of up to about 20. That's the largest. So again, as I said, not nearly as large groups as impala. And usually in pairs or groups of 6 to 8, somewhere around there. And especially what I've seen in the area. I think it also depends on the area that you're in. But that was, what a great surprise. So funny, I was driving and I saw these impala. I thought, hang on, that looks different. That's not something we see every day. And it does these reedback. Fantastic. Just shows you, you never know what you're going to bump into out here. And that's what makes it so exciting. And that's why I love doing what I do. Every day is different. We're going to continue searching Cheetah Plains for a while, and while I do that, let's see what Taylor's update is.
Oh, you're back with me. You're just going to have to watch the bushes for just a moment. Look how beautiful the vegetation is looking over here. Well, we'll see. We're heading towards where that buffalo is. That's our plan. I'm just checking to see if I can see any vultures. I haven't seen any just yet. I saw one earlier, but I don't think that there are any vultures around, or perhaps they've already landed. I'm not 100% certain. Something for sure, though, is I know that the elephants have been busy over the last few days creating these amazing roadblocks, which we have to squeeze through past the trees. Well, we're safely on the other side again. We're getting closer. Maybe we should also check that first kill that we found that was covered in maggots and see how that's going. That'll be quite interesting to see. Perhaps there'll be some birds that are maybe feeding on those maggots now. We seem to see that quite often. Ooh, I just want to double check. Do I need to go down there? Do I need to get to Drakensberg Road? Okay, I'm actually going to go a little bit further. Can we go along here? Let's go. I think I saw some buffalo up ahead, so let's quickly go ahead there. I want to see for myself very quickly where I am. Let me go back here. I'm just trying to have a very quick look. We're going to get your cheetah cut line now. That's exciting. Like I said, I did think I saw some buffalo. Let's see if we can get to them. And then we will get back onto Drakensberg Road and take it from there. Perhaps the buffalo were a little bit further away. They could have been on Torchwood side. I saw them just over the horizon, so I think they were just on the other side. I can actually see them. I can see them all. Here they all are. Oh my goodness. Okay, I see a big group of buffalo. Let's have a look at them. There's also lots of zebra around. It's all happening here this afternoon. There's an array of animals that have decided to congregate in this area, but let's find the buffalo. Now the buffalo, better be very careful because the lions are out and about. We go forward a little bit more. I think we're going to get a little gap through here. How's that, Javi? Can you see anyone? There's a buffalo there. Now, there seems to be not a massive herd of them, just a few, maybe about 20 or so, all scattered out in the bushes, moving towards the shade. I suspect that they'll be on their way towards Biffles Hook Dam. Ooh, can hear some zebras alarming in the distance. I think that's where everyone is heading, the zebra, definitely the buffalo. Right, oh, I know a few of you are going to be very happy to see what Byron has found for you this afternoon.
Look at this, a side-striped jackal, everyone. That is fantastic. I haven't seen one of these for a long time. And amazing light. I'm a bit upset I left my camera back at the lodge. There it goes, the side-striped jackal. We get two species of jackal in the area, the black-backed jackal and then the side-striped jackal. Black-backed jackal, probably a bit more prevalent in most parts of the Kruger, but I find in the Sabi Sands what I've seen in most areas is there are a lot of side-striped jackal. Let me see if I can quickly find you a picture of the two different species just so you can see the difference. So Mary and James were both asking for jackal this afternoon, and there we go. That was a beautiful, quick view, but a beautiful view of that jackal out in the open. Let me show you quickly in the book the difference between the two species. So there we go. We've got the black-backed jackal at the top and the side-striped jackal at the bottom, the one that we just saw. See the side-striped jackal, uniform in color, but it has got a little bit of a side stripe along the body, and occasionally you can see that a lot clearer on certain animals. And then if you look up to the top, the black-backed jackal, it's got a clear line going through the body, changing color, going with that black back and then that orange-brown underbelly and inside of the jackal. So very different in color, similar in size. The side-striped jackal can be a little bit bigger, but they are similar in size, maybe about a kilogram or two heavier, a little side-striped jackal. And the side-striped jackal do scavenge a little bit, but not as much
as the black-backed jackal. Black-backed jackal you'll often find around carcasses where hyena or lions are, and they'll be hanging around on the outskirts trying to get a little piece of the carcass. Side-striped jackal, I know, have even been known to feed on fruit. And I think it actually gives you, let me see if I can get the rest of the diet here. But I've read before insects and fruit, but they do scavenge a little bit. I have seen them at carcasses. And let's see, so omnivorous species, as I was saying. So they feed on a number of fruit and insects, as well as carrion. And apparently, occasionally, the odd reptile. So I'm assuming a little lizard or something, if they find it. But all the rest of that, too. Whereas the black-backed jackal is predominantly a carnivore and feeds mainly on carrion or dead meat. That was amazing. Gee, it's all happening here this afternoon. Little animals we don't see often. I'm sure you're all very happy and as excited about the jackal as I am. That was really great. Some impala just moving across in front of us. We're going to slowly start making our way back towards Juma now. Just see what we can find around there. Maybe give Taylor a hand. Wonder if she's had any luck with the lions yet, but we'll see. And I know you bumped into Herbert. Herbert said he was going to help us try and find a leopard this afternoon. So maybe he finds some tracks. A lot of elephant tracks in the road ahead. Possibly from this afternoon, it looks like it. And I know Taylor was heading towards one of the buffalo carcasses we found this morning. I think she's just got there. Let's see what's happening around there.
We have indeed arrived at the buffalo, who unfortunately is not alive anymore. He has succumbed to his injuries, which I suspected to be a horn to a very sensitive part of his body. And you can see where he bled out. If you remember, if you watched this morning, you would have seen the lions lapping up the blood. That is the pool from which they were drinking it. Now, they haven't come back. The reason why I parked so close, because I wanted to have a look at the pile of blood. You can almost see where his front legs are, how he was struggling, unfortunately, a little bit earlier as he was fading into his final minutes of life. Now, of course, this is very, very sad, and it's unfortunate that this has happened, but it is life, and now it has provided a meal, whether it's going to be for the lions, for the vultures, for the hyenas, even like a jackal, which you've just seen, would happily feed on something like a buffalo. This is what happens. The strongest will survive, and the weakest, unfortunately, will move on. But those ticks are absolutely massive, how they've swelled up, and there's a variety of different ticks there. I can't imagine that those ticks that have almost swelled up to the size of an almond now would be able to get any bigger. They look like they're about to burst. And you can slowly see the flies coming down. And soon it'll be covered in flies, very much like the other buffalo carcass. I think what we're going to do, though, is we're going to leave this carcass. I'm going to go back to the one that was covered in all the maggots, because there's clearly no lions here. And it sounded like Taxon said that the lions are still in Torchwood and they're fast asleep. So we'll have to just listen out. I'm just checking over my shoulder and see when they come back across. And of course, we will try to get in then. But rest in peace, buffalo. Thank you for providing a meal to the rest of the animals. Now we need to just quickly get out here. And we need to go back to the central Drakensberg Junction. where we'll be able to find the other carcass. Now, I'm hoping that we're going to be upwind again of the carcass like we were this morning. We're not going to get an awful smell, even though I can smell something, and I think it could be the other buffalo. Oh my goodness, a lot of animals have died here. Can you see that kudu? Oh my goodness, this is sort of very much like a graveyard. That was once a kudu with a beautiful set of horns. Perhaps the lions killed it. It doesn't seem to be very, very old. The horn moths haven't even started developing on the keratin yet, the keratin moths. Right, but let's continue towards that very terrible smell that's coming from the distance. Makes me nervous trying to get up close and personal with the next buffalo. I don't think I'll have the biggest smile on my face. You may see some interesting sort of body language from me when I get there. Ew, can you smell that, David? It's smelling ripe. Actually, I can see some vultures. That's going to be quite interesting. They're in the distance on the tree. When we get a bit closer, we should be able to have a look. That's good for us. Perhaps they have spotted the carcass, because that's exactly where we need to go. Let's have a look from a distance. Who's up there? Are they in vultures? One vulture. And that looks like another vulture. Is it another vulture? Yes, it is. It's just got its head tucked in, the white-backed vultures, perched up on this tree. But let's not wait any longer. Let's go in for a closer inspection. I think that's a great idea. Ooh, it's smelling very vile, but let's go back across to Byron, who's also got something with feathers.
I have indeed, much smaller than a vulture though. These are little white crested helmet shrikes. And they're beautiful little birds, look at that. Now these birds are very interesting too. They're always in groups. They just took off. They flew. Always in little groups. But beautiful birds. You often hear them, but again, also sometimes difficult to see. They fly off quite quickly. Let's see if the group takes off again. There are a few of them in that bush, just jumping about. See where the rest are. There's one or two lower down, almost at the base of the tree. There we go. Look at that. Beautiful. And they've got this beautiful yellow around the eye. You can see that there. Lovely. Interesting thing with these birds, and there they go, they've just flown off. Interesting thing with these birds, with the white-crested helmet shrikes, is that they are always in groups, but there's almost an alpha and alpha male and female, and they're the ones that mate, and they're the ones who then have lay eggs, and those chicks will then join the group of birds, which is interesting. Not many bird species do that. So, similar to wild dog almost, where there's an alpha male and female and they give birth to the pups, or alpha female does. Similar with these birds with the white crested helmet shrikes. There's a dominant pair or alpha pair and they will lay their eggs. Nice to see them. We've had a good birding afternoon so far. So James Richard, good afternoon to you. And James would like to know, what is the largest cuckoo which occurs in this area? And I'm trying to think the largest one. I'd have to check the sizes for you, James, but it might be the red-chested cuckoo. I think that's the largest. The common or maybe even the Jacobin. They're all similar in size. So I'll have to double check for you. We will, and I'll get back to you with the answer. But they are all very similar in size. going to be heading out of Cheetah Plains now, and back towards Juma. Jan would like to ask, have I ever found a Pell's fishing owl? And Jan, unfortunately not, I haven't. I've been in areas where the Pell's fishing owl is found. You have to really find it. But I have not yet seen one. I'll have to try again at some point. Beautiful, beautiful, big owl, massive owl, one of the largest owl species we have. And they do nest in large trees along the back of rivers or close to rivers. And obviously fish, hence the name, the fishing owl. And what they'll do is they'll find a perch, and it's a feeding spot. And they'll go and sit there, and they'll feed on their fish that they've caught. You can imagine this massive owl flying down and diving into the water, catching fish. Or using its talons to grab the fish as it flies over. But no, I haven't found one yet, or I haven't seen one yet. We're going through a patch with dodgy signal at the moment, so let's see what Taylor's up to again.
Well, you've caught us doing a fair amount of off-roading. I'm desperately trying to find that first buffalo carcass we stumbled across, and it is proving a lot more difficult than what I thought it was going to be. So I think, David, we're going to have to follow our noses, quite literally. So we smelt it, and it's very pungent. Oh, what is biting me? Get off. Get off of my foot. Get out of my sock and out of my shoe. I don't know what it was, but it was big and it was crawling on my leg, and it looked like it had very big mandibles, and I did not want to be bitten, hence my little squeal, and I threw it straight out of the vehicle, not interested in examining it. Now I can smell the stench coming off the buffalo, so we can't be too far away, but if I remember correctly, it was quite far in. And we did have to do some off-roading, so I'll try and remember exactly. See if we can't see those vultures again. The vultures that we did see that were roosting in the tree, unfortunately, they led us to nothing. We'll just go up a little bit further. I can't smell it anymore, can you? No. Okay, I think this buffalo hunt may be a little bit of a bust, as I can't remember exactly where it was, and I don't want to off-road unnecessarily too much. I tried to follow my tracks in, but I wasn't able to. Ah, okay. So we will carry on. I'm looking for some elephants and some cuckoos. Now, Lauren, you are wondering, how do you tell the difference between a male and a female vulture? With great difficulty. There is virtually no sexual dimorphism between the vultures. Perhaps the male is just slightly bigger and has a slightly longer wingspan. But other than that, I think it is very, very difficult. I surely can't tell them apart. But maybe we'll try and have a look. But no obvious sort of features, like different colors or anything like that. So it's a tough one, Lauren. I'm sure only the experts of birds would maybe be able to tell them apart. But we can have a little go at it. We will try when we find some more. But now I don't know where that carcass is. And if I remember correctly, it was quite far off the road. So we could have been driving off-road for quite some time. That's okay. We will carry on. And it seems as though those pesky gremlins are back on form. Maybe those gremlins like the heat, and they tend to come out and maybe breed with all the rain that we had, and that's why we're seeing an abundance of them. It's sort of a boom, like what we sometimes see with the termites, or sort of once a year when we have that explosion of termites. I think we have an explosion of gremlins currently, but don't worry. That'll be okay. We'll fight them off with everything we've got. Now I'm hoping that those lions are going to come across. Oh, but I've got some little mongoose here. Hello, little mongoose. Let's see if they're going to come out. They've just ducked down into the side of this termite mound. So I'm going to sit quietly and let's see if they decide to come out. Oh, we're being very patient, waiting for these mongoose to pop their heads out of this termite mound, in case you've just turned the show on and wondering what on earth are we looking at. There were some tiny grey mongoose, dwarf mongoose, that just, there we go, there's one popped its head out right at the base of the tree. Yes, patience is the key when you're out in the bush. Not so nervous with us, hasn't really even had a look at us just yet. And of course the mongoose knows we're here. There we go. Hello. More worried about what else is around it. It knows that we don't want to eat it, but there are plenty of eagles and hawks and all sorts of other raptors around that would find them a tasty snack. And it didn't seem to be a whole family. It just seemed to be two of them, which is quite unusual. So perhaps the others are in the distance foraging elsewhere. Look at those long claws that they've got, very powerful claws. So they can dig through the hard substrate, the sands and the clay, in order to dig beetles out, look for scorpions, and all those little things. Here we go, coming out now, not worried about us at all. Where's your friend? Your friend perhaps not as relaxed as you are. One of the things I absolutely love to do is get my guests out of the vehicle and actually get them to sit on the ground and wait for the mongoose to come out and carry on with their day. Very much like how we're sitting in the vehicle now. We waited patiently. That often happens as well. They're very curious creatures. But I think Byron has managed to fend off the gremlins and has found you a giraffe.
And we have indeed found a giraffe, and we've focused on those long legs at the moment. Wonderful. It's a beautiful female. We found a group of giraffe, or a journey of giraffe. Some people also refer to them as a tower of giraffe. There's some buffalo wandering through this area too. Some of the other giraffes have just moved off. There we go, there's a buffalo through there. It's always lovely seeing these giraffe feeding. They're so graceful. Just wandering past. And they walked across the road right in front of us. Nice to see that beautiful, that gait of theirs, the way their legs move when they walk. There's lovely sunlight this afternoon too. It's still fairly windy. The wind has picked up quite a bit this afternoon. I think possibly bringing in some bad weather. See that tongue. There we go. See that tongue stick out and wrap around the branch to pull the leaves off. They've got amazingly long tongues. It's about, I think some of the bigger giraffe, the big males, their tongues can reach the length of about 45 centimeters, which is very, very long, more than a ruler length. And James Richard, just getting back to your question from earlier, James asked which cuckoo is the largest in the area. And I was saying possibly a Jacobin. You know, they're all very similar in size, but what I read is the largest is actually the Levalent cuckoo, who used to be known as the striped cuckoo. Looks very similar to the Jacobin, except for some streaking down the body. And that is the largest. It's about 39 centimeters long. So that is the largest cuckoo that we get in this area. My giraffe was starting to move off. Wasn't that great? Nice little surprise. And all these buffalo just off to the left. Little herd moving through here. Trying to find a bit of grass to feed on. They really are struggling at the moment. Very peaceful this afternoon. So relaxing. It's really great to be out here. It's still very, very warm though. It's been a hot afternoon. It's amazing how the weather's changed in the last 2 days, from the morning to the afternoon. Yesterday morning too, we also had a bit of rain or cloud cover. This morning, same thing. We thought it was really going to rain and it was building, and then it missed us. But the afternoons have cleared up and become really, really warm. Oh, wasn't that nice? A little surprise. Buffalo and giraffe. Fantastic. Let us continue. We're still heading back towards Juma. In a westerly direction, so driving into the sun for a little bit. Oh, there's a buffalo about to cross the road in front of us. Hang on a second. Sorry, I didn't mean to startle you. You first. This is a female. Just joining the rest of the herd. Oh, great. All right, let us continue. And while I do that, let's see what Taylor's up to.
There are any leopards around. It's lovely and cool down here. David, don't you wish we could just drive the rest of the game drive up and down over here? Degrees Celsius cooler than it is on top. Would be a very good.
It looks like Taylor's got some gremlins now, but I found an interesting bird up here that I'd like to show you. One that we have seen before, right up at the top of the tree. There you go. One with that very long tail, and it's calling for us at the moment. Let's listen to the call quickly. Anyway, that is a magpie shrike, but while I've stopped here, I've found something else very interesting. I'm going to jump off quickly. Hang on a second. Oh, great. Look here. This side, Vildy, sorry, this side. Look at this. Can you see this little guy over here? It is a... I'm not going to disturb it or pick it up because it is very dry at the moment, but that is a... Speaks hinged back tortoise. Trying to get away from me. Like I said, I don't want to pick him up or disturb him because it is very, very dry at the moment, and tortoises rely so much on storing water. Look how he's crawled right in there, trying to get away from us. But luckily we didn't disturb him at all. Often what happens is if you do pick up tortoises, which you should never do, they release the water that they store as a defense mechanism, but that can then cause dehydration, especially in dry conditions like this. But this is a different tortoise that we don't often see. So we get two tortoise species in this area. And the one is the leopard tortoise, the quite large leopard tortoise, which everybody's used to see. And the other one is this little Speke hinge-backed tortoise. The carapace is a lot thinner, a lot smaller. It doesn't get that big mound that the leopard tortoise gets. And it has got a little bit of a hinge at the back of the tortoise shell, or the carapace, which overlaps slightly, and that's how it gets its name. That is great. Just shows you, when you're stopping, you could look at little birds or something small, and things happen around you all the time. That was really great. I've really enjoyed this afternoon so far because we found different things. We found the jackal, we found the reedback, the tortoise. We saw a cuckoo. Unfortunately, we didn't get to show you, but they're definitely out there, so we'll still try and find them. Saw the bee eaters. It's been a wonderful afternoon. Andre, I'm glad you enjoyed that magpie shrike. Apparently it's your favorite bird. I do like them too. Beautiful long tails. Taylor seems to have a signal back, beaten off the gremlins. Let's see what she's up to now.
Obviously, the gremlins don't want to hear me speak today. Maybe they've heard enough of the sound of my voice and they keep playing horrible pranks on them. But somebody should inform them that it's not April yet and they should not be allowed for such jokes. Now, we did carry on checking the drainage line, and I apologize, Nyala Road is notorious to be a bit of a dodgy signal spot, but we're back in full force and we're still checking along the drainage. And we're making our way towards the dam cam to have a look and see if anybody is around. Perhaps Henry's there. We could check on Henry and see how his injury is doing on his back. And maybe there's some giraffe. Maybe there's, I'm hoping really for some elephants. That's why we are going there, to try and find some elephants that would possibly be splashing around. And I'm sure that there have been elephants the entire day in that area. Oh no. I believe the dam cam is down. Sorry about that. I will just have to go to the camera itself and we'll have to have a look like that, won't we? We're coming up to it now. We're not for. Oh, you know what else we could do? We could double check and have a look if the crested barbet nest is still active. We're going to do that. What does that sound like to you, David? There we go. So we're coming around to that. Was it in a marula tree, I think it was? Or an apple leaf, one of the two. We'll have a look at it now. I can see it in the distance. And again, lots of zebra footprints. They seem to be all over at the moment. I think I've seen in the last couple of days more zebra than I've seen in Parla. I scan the distance. I can see the zebra. I can see some kudu. So long. Oh, we've got some nice kudu bulls. That's going to be really beautiful. So let's cross the dam wall and let's cross it to get to the other side. Oh, we've got a giraffe though. Wow, you've blended in well to the trees. You can see him just moving over the top of the dam wall. I didn't even see him there. A combination of the sun in my eyes and he looked very much like a tree. So his camouflage is working quite well today. Oh, let's have a look here. Hi, Mr. Giraffe. Here he is. Beautiful big boy, but he's going back behind his tree. That's okay. David, look at those beautiful kudu in the distance. Now, it's quite a distance away. We'll try and get a little bit closer. But have a look at those beautiful males crossing the open there. You can see the dam cam. Hello, dam cam.
how they're all walking in a straight line. Isn't that beautiful? Being backlit. There you go, getting to a little bit of a trot. Not quite comfortable out in the open on a windy day like today. Nope, now they're getting into a bit of a gallop. Look how easy they cover the ground. They've got such big strides on those long, dainty legs. It seems as though they're heading for the hills, looking for some shelter where they'll be able to utilize their best sense, which is, of course, their hearing, and an impala. All varying in ages. The oldest seems to be taking up the lead here, and then two youngsters following quite closely behind. Stopping to have a little look while they're out in the open. Both of them are having a look. Oh, that's a nice photo. Oh, they're almost mirroring each other. They did exactly the same movements. Here we go. All the horns are lining up now. All the stripes matching. And the one that's sort of closest to us didn't seem to have the biggest body, but it definitely had the largest set of horns, and we see that sometimes. I definitely noticed it down in the Eastern Cape on the southeast coast of South Africa, where the kudus here didn't have the, or down there, sorry, didn't have the biggest bodies, but had massive horns. And up here, they seem to have a combination of both. They seem to have really big spiraled horns, as well as big bodies to go with it. But let's go across the dam wall. Now, it doesn't seem like there's anything in the water. But we'll have a look. I'll have a scan from the distance. And if there isn't anything there, well, then the next bet will be to go to Chele Pan. Oh, no, it doesn't look like there's much going on over there. Right, but let's go around and see if Chele Pan has perhaps got something happening over that side. Nothing really happening at the dam now, that's all right. Oh, but we've got a little virtual starling. Let's see if you're going to land for us. I think it may. I'll try and roll into the sighting. You can see it sitting up on that dead branch there. Hello. Very hot. You can see how its beak is wide open, trying to cool itself down, dropping down straight to the ground. You did that quite easily, considering you look quite hot and flustered. But I suppose you can't let the heat get you down, and you have to keep eating. Very nice. I'm surprised that we're not seeing a few more birds splashing around at the water. Because even something like a bird needs to try and cool down, and the best way to do that, well, it's to have a little bath and actually clean your feathers the good way. And the starlings in particular don't mind the water. You often see the Cape glossy starling, the one with the bright orange eye, having baths on regular occasions. Yeah, who's been walking here? It's just the buffalo that have been coming up and down the entire day. Perhaps we'll have to head back to the elephants that I told you that we saw very early in the drive, but they were moving through quite a dense patch. Maybe they would have popped up, and I suppose they were actually going in the direction of Chele Pan. What? We'll have to see if we're going to get them. Look at that cloud, how it's building up. That is quite beautiful, don't you think? It's almost like a wall of clouds is engrossing the sky. You can see how it's built up vertically now and is spreading horizontally. I think there could be rain coming. This is going to be an interesting cloud to watch as the next few hours pass, because I suspect we're going to see some lightning coming from that. Wouldn't that be nice to catch some lightning, some
spectacular bolts in the distance at the back of the clouds. That would be quite nice to see. And I've been saying for the last few days, that's definitely something that I would like to catch, are the bolts of lightning in the big cumulonimbus clouds. But at the moment, there seems to just be lots of cirrus and cumulus clouds around, which will hopefully develop at some point into big thunderstorm clouds, very much like the one we just saw. But we need lots of them. Okay, I'm going to carry on making our way towards Chele Pan, my favorite little watering hole. And while I do that, let's go back to Byron and see where he is.
I'm back on Juma, Taylor, and no luck just yet. Just been seeing a few impala dotted around through the thickets. Seen a lot of elephant tracks in the roads recently. And hang on, there we go. As I say that, we found the elephant. There we go, have a look. They're just up ahead here. It looks like a nice herd. Yeah. Dotted around. Oh, great. My favorites. Fantastic. Oh, there's one screaming in the distance. Doesn't sound too happy. Hear them communicating off to the right here. Kevin has asked us a question about the family dynamics of elephant, and do herds ever merge into one herd? Do they split up? Yes, Kevin, depending on the time of year, availability of food and water, I have seen herds merge and move around together when they are looking for food and water, especially in the dry season. There's a nice big adult female. And then Kevin, and then depending on the, you know, usually in the summer, you might get those herds splitting up again and moving into different areas, and the close-knit family will stay together. But yes, elephant herds can merge at times. See if I can move forward a little bit. There's, like I said, quite a few elephant around here, spread out nicely through this area. And the younger one around here. Look at them feeding, and this one that Vim is focused on now, feeding off an acacia tree. Very, very sharp thorns, but it doesn't seem to bother them. It's amazing how these elephants are able to feed on some of these branches and trees. And you can hear the branches breaking around us from by the other elephant. Lauren has asked us a question regarding the pregnancy of an elephant and how long are elephants pregnant for. And Lauren, it is very long. It's 22 months. The gestation period of an elephant is 22 months. So it is a long time. Look at this little one nudging the mother, or the larger one rather. I'm not sure if it is the mother or not. Very possibly. If it is that close to her. But elephants are very social animals. So within a herd, you'll have the females interacting with all the youngsters and all the youngsters interacting with the adults. But generally, the female will only suckle her own calf. Now, so 22 months, Lauren, it's a long time. Very long gestation period. So David in Napa has asked us an interesting question again about the herds merging and if a single matriarch would then guide both herds into areas to look for food and that. David, I don't think it would be a single matriarch. I think it would be the older elephants in the herd. The reason for that is they probably remember where to find food and water and they will lead the rest of the herd to those areas. So I don't think it's necessarily one matriarch. Could be a number of dominant elephant within the herd, or older elephant rather. And even if you watch elephant herds in general moving around, even though there is a matriarch that looks after the herd in terms of safety and taking them from one place to another, often the movement of the herd isn't always determined by her. The other elephant could decide and will move and the rest of the herd will follow. But the matriarch does tend to, she will try her best to look after the herd in terms of their best interests, so which areas they need to move into. But once they move into certain areas, they can spread out and move all over, and she'll just follow and move with the herd. These others seem to be moving a bit closer, so let's sit tight here. And maybe we get some elephants coming quite close again. We've been so fortunate the last few days with wonderful elephant sightings. I'm so happy to see them. I love spending time with them. Oh, look at the little one. Hello. This is amazing. You can see they have been splashing water and mud on themselves. We're just going to sit quietly as they walk past. Isn't this fantastic? Yes. See, that's a big male at the back, the last one to cross the road. There he goes. It's amazing how quiet they are as they move past us. That was incredible. Such a lovely, lovely sighting. To have that whole herd come past, that little one, various ages and sizes, and that big male at the back. Going to move forward for us a little bit. It's going to move very, very slowly. What a wonderful sighting. Oh, looking into the sun a little bit now. But an elephant silhouette isn't always a bad thing. Look at that, that's just lovely. Huge grey animals moving through the bush.
now so relaxed. Listen. Oh, there's a lot of vocalization going on. So did you hear that grumble, that low frequency grumble or vocalization that the elephant give off? And then there was a screech from another elephant in the distance. And that could usually mean it's possibly a younger elephant that is trying to suckle and the mother's not allowing it. I've seen that a number of times. And those youngsters then get very upset and they screech and they make such a loud noise. And I think that's possibly what that was, because the rest of the herd have stayed very calm and relaxed around here. So I don't think it was a distress call or anything serious. I think probably just an upset teenager or youngster that is not getting the milk at once. Look how that little one climbed over that branch. Christy has asked us, are there any animals in the bush that wag their tails just because they're happy? Christy, I don't think so. I've never seen it. And look at that. Speaking about tails, that one's lost half of its tail, that elephant. And that could be from a number of things. And that's what it's meant to look like. And that one's lost it. It could very possibly be from ticks, perhaps, that have infected the tail and caused the tail to fall off. That has happened in the past. Maybe when it was younger, it damaged its tail. It's unlikely it would be from a predator in this area, but that can happen in certain areas. I've seen up in Zambia especially, where elephants cross the Zambezi River on a regular basis. A lot of elephant there without tails. That's because the crocodiles come past and try their luck and they grab a tail and just end up with a piece of the tail from the elephant. But Christy, getting back to your question regarding animals wagging the tails, I don't think so at all. I think the reason the tails are there is to keep flies and insects away. They are used occasionally as warning signs. So animals like lions, if you're tracking them or approaching them and they are feeling threatened and they feel and they are going to show signs of aggression, they will flick their tail from side to side very, very quickly. So that is a clear indication that they are aggressive and they're not happy. Elephant too, they'll often cause or make his tail stand up straight or straight back and stiffen that tail, and that's a sign that they're also not happy. So they'll use them to show that they perhaps aggressive or unhappy or feeling threatened, but I've never seen them wag a tail like a dog would to show that it's happy. I think it's mainly to keep insects and flies away. Such an incredible sighting. Very special. I'm so happy with this afternoon's drive. It's been really a lot of fun. We've seen some great stuff already. Hope all of you at home are still enjoying it. All right, they're moving off further into the thicket now, so we'll leave the herd and maybe spend some more time in search of other animals. But before I do that, Daniel has just asked an interesting question. Daniel would like to ask, do elephant ever give birth to twins? Yes, Daniel, they do. Oh, there's another elephant sound in the distance. Daniel, I've never seen it personally. I think it's very difficult. I've seen young calves of similar age that are possibly twins, but I didn't see them at birth, so I'm not too sure. But I do know of records in other parts of South Africa and Southern Africa with elephants giving birth to twins. So it does happen, yes. Anyway, let us continue. Thanks for that question, Daniel. It's still very warm, still quite muggy. I still don't see any serious cloud buildup. Waiting for it. I do hope it rains tonight and cools everything down. Uh,
Ah, and it sounds like Taylor's got some predators for you to look at.
It is crazy what is going on. The Ngahumas had killed another buffalo. Now, I don't know if they killed this between the game drives, because apparently they were all over on Torchwood. And now they're back here, so perhaps they were quite split up. I didn't hear how many lions they had on the other side. But they're back in Vuyatelo, which is good news. Oh, listen to that. Now those youngsters are fighting over the carcass. It doesn't even look like the females have opened it at all. So that is absolutely incredible. You can see them growling and fighting and chewing on those very soft bits, which is the easiest spot for the cubs to get into. You can understand why there's a little bit of tension around that small gap. Those little ones' teeth unfortunately are not strong enough to cut through the hide just yet. No, they all have to make do and chew in the same spot. That is incredible. So then Kahuma's killed a buffalo the day before. They killed a buffalo this morning, and then they've killed another buffalo in between drives. That is incredible. And of course they've got the other carcass. Eat on. Those two are having a big argument. It seems to be one of the older cubs that is making all that noise and growling while the others groom themselves, keep each other clean. I can't imagine they would be starving with all the buffalo they've eaten over the last few days. Seems as though they're feeding on perhaps some of the intestines. You can see they've got a little bit of feces on their nose, so maybe they were trying to eat all the skin that surrounds the intestines. Very nice. Both of them have got faces full of dung. Sorry, I'm just taking a little sip of water. There we go. You can almost see right inside. Now, there is a dirty face. That was the one that was making all the noise and causing all the commotion. They seem to be taking turns. There we go, trying to grab a bit of the intestine. Pull, you've got to pull hard. Oh, they're coming right over to say hello. I think they're going to the rest of the pride. Oh no, just going to plonk themselves down right here. Oh, look how dirty you are. Sis, if that was me, I'd be in a lot of trouble. I don't think my mother would let me inside the house. But luckily they don't live indoors. But that is very dirty. Just counting, there are five females here, adults here, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, all cubs are here, and one of the Birminghams just laying in front, fast asleep. I can't see which Birmingham it is at the moment. Now I wonder where the other Birmingham is, because yesterday afternoon we had both boys, we had Mfumo and Tinyo both present. But not this afternoon. And this morning I didn't see him either. I didn't see any Birminghams this morning, but I believe there was one. I think Byron got to see him. Ah, thank you, Kirsty. Kirsty says that it was Mfumo that was with the pride, so I assume that it is him that is laying here. Perhaps Tinyo is not going to stick around anymore because the females have finished their estrus cycle. And it is sort of the way how it goes, isn't it? They have an argument, Tinyo and Mfumo, over a few days that the lionesses come into estrus. And Mfumo is really the one that hangs around and seems to look after the Nkuhumas rather than Tinyo. He seems to prefer his time around the sticks and occasionally come through to the Nkuhumas. But thank goodness it is starting to cool down now. That breeze is very welcoming.
Well, the vultures are going to be around in this area all day from tomorrow. Now, you won't believe it, just before we came here, I saw a herd of buffalo actually coming down in this direction, which is going to be quite interesting. Sorry, Kirst, I've completely lost the name out of my head and I don't want to make a name up now. Debbie. I thought it was Debbie, but just in case, like this morning, I was making all sorts of names up. Sorry, Debbie. Debbie, you want to know how close all the carcasses are to each other? They're almost placed out in a triangle. I apologize. My hands are very dirty. I had to pull a stick out from underneath the vehicle, so they're nice and black now. It was a burnt stick, so I've got sort of charcoal all over my hands. Now, they're not far away, probably about 200 meters, maybe 250 meters away from the second carcass that we found. From Torchwood, probably about another 100 meters, maybe 150 meters. So we're not far at all. We're in very, very close range. Look at that one's face. Oh my goodness. You look like you had a great time. You look like my brother after he has eaten a plate of ribs. Barbecue ribs, that's what he looks like, and almost exactly the same, even getting some mess around his eyes. I always found it quite funny how he was able to do that. The messiest eater you have ever seen in your life. Now, I'm the complete opposite. I'm a bit strange. I have to eat the ribs and anything with a knife and fork. Hello, little one. You enjoy your buffalo bum? It doesn't even look like they've eaten the eyes from that buffalo, just having a little glance over there. So it can't be too old. I wonder when they did this. Oh, maybe they've eaten the eye. No, it seems to still be there. We just can't see what's happening on the other side of its face, unfortunately. They have got food for days. Well, they better eat as much as they can off of this buffalo, because they'll need to move on to the one that we found earlier today. Otherwise, the vultures are going to see it and devour the carcass. Now, Susie, you're wondering how sure we are that they killed this buffalo. Well, because when we came through here this morning, I think I drove Mumba Road about three times. I didn't see any kill over here. And the buffalo have still been hanging around. Remember, we saw them briefly when they looked sort of panicked after we spent some time with the lions. And then they indeed did move north from there. They looked like they were going south, but they turned around and they came north. So I suspect that maybe while they were moving around, maybe the pride was split up completely. Like I said, I didn't hear how many they initially had when they found them on Torchwood again this afternoon. So I think that they definitely killed this buffalo. I don't remember seeing this one dying at all, or any buffalo really around here from this morning. We're going to hang around with the lovely Nkuhumas for a little bit longer, but I know that Byron has got a beautiful African sunset to show you.
I do indeed, Taylor. One of my favorite times of the day. We said so yesterday, there's not as much cloud cover around, but we've got this beautiful silhouetted tree with the sun setting behind it. I always say this depending on where you are around the world and the time of year. The time of day. Depending on the time of day, it's always nice to have a little sunset drink. Sundowner, as we always call it in the bush. And you can see these elephants right in front of us. And they're preventing us from going past. We've been sitting here for about 5 minutes, and they're very relaxed, but there's no chance of us getting past them. So we're just going to sit, enjoy the elephant, and enjoy the sunset. They're so peaceful. There's so many elephants around, but there are some, looks like heading towards the water. So I'm hoping that this female decides to move. Otherwise, we'll have to just drive around her and then maybe we get some elephants drinking. Hayley, I'm so glad you are enjoying the sunset just as much as I am. It's really, really lovely. Looks like a male has joined these two now. Sheesh, look at that. Look at the power. Just it's almost like he wants to move it so he can come through. Oh no, he's trying to get to some of the roots, it looks like. Catching the last little bit of that sunset in the background. Let's have a look at that. Just about to drop beyond that tree line. That golden color, just amazing. I'm not sure if you can hear, there's some hornbills calling in the tree off to our right. We can't really see them from where we are, but I can just hear them. There they go again, listen. They're just up in that tree. Comes this male. Well, he got the female to move out the way, but now he is in the road. Doesn't look like we're going anywhere anytime soon. Christine, thank you for your comment. You're saying that you think every drive should end with elephant because it's so peaceful. And it is. It really is wonderful. Oh, there's a lot of elephant around us. Viam and I are basically surrounded by elephant at the moment. Not necessarily close to us, but whichever direction I look in, there are some elephant. I look across the way through this little drainage line. There's some elephant down there. Okay, I am going to try and make a plan to get around this elephant because it does look like the herd is moving down towards the water. I'm not too sure, but we did see some water in here the other day. So maybe we're lucky and we get some elephants drinking the last few drinks of water. So bear with me a second, but I think stay with me. Sorry, sir. See if he's going to move. I don't want to disturb him. I'm going to back up and rather go around. There's no need to try and push him out the way. Okay, let's do this quite quickly. Like I said, stay with us and you can see how much fun it is trying to get around elephant as opposed to going past them. And then hopefully we get those... Oh, the rest of the herd down at the waterhole drinking. Let me see. I think I've found a little gap here. Oh, sorry, little one. The young elephant is a little upset with us trying to get around him. He's going back to the mother. Don't worry, we're almost around them. The joys of having a Land Rover just to get around roadblocks like this. Okay, let's see. These elephants are coming out into the open ahead of us. Some of them have just moved past. Just trying to see. I'm sure I saw some water in here the other day. Let's have a look. Just have a look. Oh, there is water here, but they're not coming down to drink.
is a pity. That is a pity. But look at the herd that we've got behind us. Isn't this fantastic? The sun's just dropped, but we've got beautiful light. Still a little bit of an orange haze in the distance on the horizon with that sunset. But look at this herd of elephants spread out over this area. And Tammy's made a comment about the elephant, and Tammy says it's amazing how these elephants are able to move so quietly and peacefully and gracefully, even though their size is so large. And yes, Tammy, it is. It's interesting. It's very interesting to see these massive animals move through the bush with such great ease. And you know what? I've seen elephants climbing areas that you'd think they wouldn't be able to get into or get around. And they're able to climb steep embankments up and down. And also very, very quietly when they want to. They can be very quiet when moving through the bush. This is a very, very peaceful afternoon. It's a pity, but I think, this is potentially part of the same herd we saw just a little few minutes earlier. And I think they have been drinking already this afternoon. It did look like they had come from water, they had splashed a lot of mud and they were wet, a few of them. So that's possibly why they don't need any water now, and they're not drinking from this little pan. More interested in finding food. Cape turtle doves calling in the distance. Oh, I can hear some zebra also calling in the distance. It's wonderful in this afternoon. Afternoon light as the sun, the dusk, you have all these birds calling and different animals kind of giving off their last calls for the day. Let's look at all those. There's an impala. So I've got a fly buzzing around me at the moment. Let's continue to see which direction these elephants are going in. Oh dear. Looks like that female is in our way again. I've got a fly that's not leaving me alone. Oh, this is really very, very special. Lovely. I'm glad you could enjoy this with us. I'm going to go down here quickly. So, Kat in Tampa has made a comment and she would like to know, or she says, it looks like we've gone from winter straight into summer without a spring. And Kat, you're right there to an extent, you're onto something, and the reason is because it's been so dry, we haven't had rain yet. So we haven't had, this is considered our spring, but we haven't had the rainfall we really want yet. So nothing is flowering like it normally would. The vegetation hasn't become lush and very green just yet. So the heat, yes, the heat, but that's normal for this area, this time of year. We start hitting these very high temperatures, mid to high 30s.
and then eventually we'll get some rainfall and cools the temperature down a bit. Everything starts flowering, and it's a wonderful time of year as we move into the middle of our summer, which is December, January and February. That's the middle of our summer. So, but you're right, this is spring at the moment, but it looks and it feels like summer because it's so hot at the moment. But the temperature will drop again a little bit when we get some more rain. I think this is building for rain. There's a beautiful kudu bull just off to our left. Look at that. Not far from his elephant, but look at those horns. Those beautiful spiral horns of the kudu bull. See that big beard running down his neck. Lovely. We've been fortunate with the amount of antelope we've seen this afternoon. That reed buck, something so different. That was very exciting. Some impala ahead of us. Oh, it's still very muggy. It's not really letting up this temperature. It's cooled down a little bit, but it's still very, very warm. So, it's incredible that the lions are active during this heat, but I think it's because they've been so successful. They've been hunting, and they've killed a number of buffalo. And again, you know, we mentioned it this morning and we've been speaking about it. We were fortunate enough to see a buffalo kill, or the lions bring down a buffalo. And I think at the moment it's because the buffalo are really struggling in this drought that we've been through. They haven't got the nutrients and the food that they normally would get this time of year. So they are a lot weaker and a lot easier for the lions to hunt. And I think those buffalo herds are hanging around in an area where the lions have been for quite some time. So all they're doing is, because they're so opportunistic, whenever the buffalo come through, all they do is they'll go and try and hunt the weakest of the herd of buffalo. And speaking about the lions, Taylor's still there. Let's see what they're up to now.
We're watching the lions now devouring the buffalo. They've started to tuck in and try and open it up at the stomach, where she will try and pull out all those organs. And of course, the little cub is coming over to lend a helping hand. Not welcomed very warmly though by the lioness, a few little growls. And I think while we're watching the sighting, keep your volume turned up, because I think there'll be a little bit of squabbling over this carcass. Now remember, we are on a live safari and I'd love to hear from you. I know Byron would love to hear from you too. Wow, that was an incredible message that's just come through. Jackie, thank you so much for keeping such fantastic tabs. Jackie says that we are on 47 of our cat day streak. And wouldn't it be great if we could reach to number 50? Isn't that exciting? Well, Jackie, you've just put lots of pressure on me tomorrow. We're going to have to muster up something. But I think thanks to all these buffalo that have been hanging around, that shouldn't be too much of a problem. And hopefully we'll be going to find a leopard soon. And at least in the next few days, I've almost forgotten what they look like. Here we go. Come on, little ones. I think you need to help a little bit better rather than annoy that lioness. Ooh. You can see her there showing teeth. And I always think that these little cubs at this age, when they get to about 6 months, they become quite silly. And they think that they are the big bosses, or we would say Makulu Induna, which means big boss in the local language. And I think that's what this little one thinks it is. But in fact, you are not, because we have learned that size does matter. Yes, I'm talking about you. The flies have now come back as it started to cool down. Like I said, I don't even think they enjoyed the heat today. This is fantastic. I'm glad though that they've started to tuck in just before it gets too dark for us to see them. The light is dropping very quickly, I'm afraid. David, have a look at that beautiful cloud that's now forming. I think we saw it earlier. I want to show you how it's progressing. See how it's becoming quite large, very much more like an anvil now, which is what we want. Those are the big thunderstorm clouds I was telling you about. You can just see the last of the sun catching the clouds there, that beautiful pink against the blue sky. That is really lovely. Let's hope that it keeps creeping in. Well, we actually want the wind today to keep blowing in those big clouds. No, she's up now. She's moving away. I'm going to take a lovely photo of her bloody face. You can see that. I always think it looks like they wear lipstick when they do this. She's coming right towards us, actually. Perhaps she'll give us a little look. Wowee. This is amazing. Well, we won't be able to go anywhere now. Sure, she's sitting really, really close to us, probably only about 2 meters away now. Now, Tony from Holland, you're wondering how old will the lion cubs need to be in order to be safe from being killed by any of the males? So I'm just moving out of the way here. Now, it depends. So the Nkumas were quite lucky because I believe with the takeover that came through, they were trying to kill some of the youngest lioness, but she managed to make it through. If I'm not mistaken, I think she lost a sibling, which was very unfortunate if that is indeed correct, and I haven't imagined that in my head. Now, I think when they get to about 2 years old, they should be all right, theoretically, but I think they would also be a little bit cautious just in case, perhaps move away until things would settle down. But if they're around a year old, they're definitely going to be killed, and at the moment, unfortunately, they would be taken out as well. This little one doesn't look very impressed that lioness didn't want to suckle. But I can't imagine you fitting anything else into your belly because it's so full. And that's a very comfortable spot. It's got its head on possibly mom's tail. Sometimes it's always hard to tell because they have such a strong bond between the various members of the pride. Very sweet when they put their heads on their paws like that. Very uncomfortable as well. Big bellies, hot day, flies bothering you. Not quite matching bellies. This lioness doesn't seem to have as big of a belly as the cub does. And isn't that a fantastic picture? You can see that I think they are definitely related, the way in which they were laying. You can see what I mean when I say that they have strong bonds between each other. Having a good old groom cuddle, isn't that precious? Now, I hope you take some good screenshots because it's getting a bit light for me, dark for me now to take some good photos, and that is absolutely adorable. Remember, you can share them on Twitter from hashtag Safari Live. Oh, the wind is really picking up now. Sorry, I keep bumping my knee on my keys. I'm laying in a rather interesting position so that you can see over the top of my head. I think you see enough of the big blonde ponytail bouncing around. Don't want it to interfere with the lions. Now they've moved off of their carcass, having another rest. Like I said, there's absolutely no hurry to eat this buffalo. This will keep them going probably for a day and a half or so. It's not a particularly big buffalo that they've caught. Now, quite an interesting question that Ellen has posed for us this afternoon. Ellen, you'd like to know
if the lions prefer to hunt and actively chase down their own prey rather than having to scavenge. Now, I don't think there's any preference. I think the fact that the Nkuhumas have just been so fantastic and so successful at the moment, remember, they haven't always been this successful. And I think it's a combination of the drought and the pans of water that are now sort of drying up that is bringing the herds back again, giving them opportunity to catch a buffalo. If there's only one or two around, it makes it also a little bit more difficult to choose a target. There's lots of young calves around that they seem to be snatching up. So I think if they aren't catching something themselves every day, perhaps they keep missing. They definitely wouldn't have walked past that buffalo like we saw this morning. Remember, they walked up to it and they did start to bite it and show a bit of interest, but there were distress calls from another buffalo going on in the distance, from the one young calf that they were taking down. And I think if it wasn't for those distress calls, then those lions would have happily sat around the second buffalo that we first saw. Lioness has now moved back over to the carcass. Need to sit up very carefully. That was not a very comfortable position I was in. Seems to be sick of trying to cut through the stomach and now just going back for the easily exposed area. Zylo from Hong Kong, you are very far away, and I'm so glad that you're watching the show. So well done for asking a really good question too. Now, you are wondering, does the blood of the buffalo quench the lion's thirst, or does it do the opposite? No, it does. Blood has got a very high content of water into it, and we often see them lapping it up. We actually saw them lapping up the blood from the previous buffalo, which we had a look at earlier in the show. And I showed you the pool of blood, where they were drinking it from. So I think once they have gorged themselves a second time, they will perhaps go back across to Buffalo's Hook Dam and have a drink. I think that's the closest water source here, maybe even Treehouse Dam. It's probably sort of equal distances away, but of course they take the shortcuts and go straight through the bush, which is often the shortest route anyway. But I'm just happy that they're back on Vuyatela again, back on Juma. Oh no, got quickly. The one was panicking a little bit there, you saw. Maybe siblings being a little bit too rough. But that's a very important hold to try and practice, even if it means testing it on your sibling. At least they don't have needle sharp teeth anymore. I think they're starting to get their adult teeth, because you know what it's like when you first get a puppy and it's only a few weeks old. It's like they've got a mouth full of needles. I just want to very quickly say goodbye. Cheers. Maybe I'll bump into you tomorrow morning. Have a lovely afternoon. Cheers, Mike. Just saying goodbye to some wonderful guests that Mike has. They actually came with a lot of hellos from a couple of the guides I used to work for. A couple of the ladies on the vehicle had been to where I previous worked, so that was quite nice. Oh no, that's not nice, to bite me on the face and in the eye. I think the cub on the left has bitten off a little bit more than it can chew. Tackling, it seems to be like an older sibling. Come on, fight back. Otherwise you're going to keep getting bullied. Now, we've been spotting the lions almost every single day now in the vehicles, and I know Louis from the UK is wondering if we ever come across the lions on bushwalk and what is sort of their behavior towards that. Now, also, once again, it depends on a couple of circumstances. I've walked into lions many a time, and it depends on sort of their nature. So some of the lions actually quite relax and don't mind you at all, but you can imagine if you were to stumble across them now with this kill,
they probably wouldn't be too impressed with you, and they may growl at you and perhaps even give you a little bit of a charge, because the cubs are around as well. They'd probably be a little bit more aggressive than usual, but if you were to bump into just the lionesses by themselves, I think that they would be all right. Every other encounter I've had, they've been fine. And these cubs are also old enough now, they're able to run away for themselves. They're not tiny and have to be carried around. So it just depends. If you block them, if you sort of come across and they're in a dense drainage line with a steep wall behind them and they feel like they cannot go anywhere else, what would you do in this situation? I'm almost certain that you probably act aggressively back to whatever was coming towards you. That's why we have to stop, look, and listen quite often while we're walking, because the animals won't just charge. They'll give off a warning call, a warning sort of just call, from a snort to a growl, anything along those, a trumpet if it's an elephant. But it's relatively all right. And the one lioness seems determined to try and open up that buffalo. Not this one, though. She's having a good sleep, a little rest, and she's still sitting right next to the vehicle. There we go. Pulling and tugging at that hide. Right, this is lovely. But let's very quickly go across to Byron and see how his afternoon is going.
Wow, that's fantastic that you got to see all those lions again and the cubs feeding. That's wonderful. I'm so glad they're doing so well. They're very successful at the moment. It's great for those cubs and for the rest of the pride. We haven't had too much luck with anything else yet. I've got the spotlight out now. And VM and I are trying to see if we can't find any nocturnal creatures. So everything from maybe a leopard coming out, walking along the road if we're really lucky. Or also, we're continuing our search for chameleons and little scorpions. Again, as I mentioned last night, it's been very, very dry. So a lot of these reptiles, like the chameleons, aren't active just yet. Hang on a second, let me just see something. I don't think so. No, that's a little flower that I see. Sure, I almost got excited there. So with it being so dry, not a lot of insects out yet. So the reptiles, like the lizards and the chameleons, they feed on a lot of the insects. So because there aren't a lot around at the moment, you don't get as much activity. And because there's not a lot of moisture, it's two little warthog just walking off, probably heading back to a burrow for the evening, going to go and rest and sleep, find safety within the termite mound. There's a kudu that moved off. There was some beautiful color in the sky earlier. It seems to have disappeared, but beautiful pink in the clouds. And I think there's some big clouds building, not really near us at the moment, in the distance to the south. But that's good. Maybe we're lucky and we still get some rain this evening. I'm going to continue our search for anything nocturnal. Taylor's still with the lions. Let's see what they're up to before we leave them.
We've still got the lions, and the light is fading very quickly, unfortunately. But we'll see how much longer we can stick with them before we lose complete light and go into total darkness. But luckily there's not too many clouds around just yet, well, where the sun is set, so it shouldn't affect the light too much. You can see these little three now. Oh, the middle one is definitely getting ganged up on. It's my favorite little lion cub, unfortunately, which is the mangy lion cub.
It seems to be spreading a little bit more, which is quite sad, but we'll see if this one is able to make it through. Perhaps the strong genetics will kick in. Now, Andrew, you're wondering if I know where the Styx Lion Pride is. Unfortunately, I'm not certain as to where they are. The last time I heard, they were on Nkoro. That was a couple of days ago. But I haven't seen them since, or even heard from any of the guides. Everybody seems to be just coming to the Nkuhumas. And I'm not even sure if the Tsalalas are around at the moment. They were hanging around on Arethusa for a couple of days too. It would be nice to see the Styx. The only time I've ever seen the Styx Pride was on my interview. I think one morning I went out with Jamie and I saw the Styx and all their 8 cubs, but unfortunately that was the first and last time I've seen them. But I'm quite happy with looking at the Nkuhumas, and I wish the Styx the best. And I hope that they all recover and are able to have another set of cubs again. Now look at this little cub. It's very cheeky. Firstly, very annoyed by all the flies. You can see them buzzing around there. And all this lioness is trying to do is to try and get into the stomach in peace. But occasionally that little cub goes over and tries to join in and help. Oh, there we go. That looked like it could have split. Now, unfortunately, I can't really reposition because I've got a lion laying right next to me. Raisa, good evening to you. Wondering if the lions have been hunting more bulls or females or perhaps calves, and if it will make a difference in the future with taking a certain sex of a buffalo. Now, they've actually been catching both male and female, young ones, old ones, healthy ones, sick ones. They've been taking whichever one they can get. Now, the only difference it will make is that if they keep taking all the young juveniles, the calves, is because obviously then we're not going to have any progeny from the previous seasons to age. They just will keep taking all the little ones, and then there'll be no little new sort of genetics to come through. But I think it's almost impossible. There are so many buffalo around that I think they could probably at this rate keep going for another few months, and I don't think it would put too much of a dent on the population. Because remember, the buffalo breed every single year they have a calf. Or almost every single year. Maybe a year and a bit. You see, buffalo don't really have too much of a season as well. I've seen brand new calves in winter. I've seen new calves in summer. I've seen them almost at all year round. Nope, not having any of it. Get off my back. Why don't the two of you go and pull on that buffalo carcass and get your frustrations out on that instead of biting each other? But I suppose it's the reaction that they like when they fight with each other. Oh, there we go. Having a little nibble. It's amazing to see how strong they are getting compared to when I first arrived, and some of them were still a little bit wobbly, not really able to climb trees, and we saw them climbing the trees so well this morning, very briefly. They've definitely improved and are getting stronger and stronger as each day goes along. Oh, here we go. She's got a very dirty face. She must have been successful in opening up that carcass slightly. Oh, coming right over to the vehicle to say hello to this other lioness. They are right next to me. There we go, walking in front of the little light that I've put on. Don't worry, it's not a bright light, it's just a little LED light. I don't think it will affect the cubs too much like a bright spotlight would, so we're going to keep the spotlight off of these cubs. Oh, we've got a stalk that looks like it's going to be happening. Laying flat on the ground. Oh, no. your plan has been ruined by one of your siblings. No, look at that, that was quite funny. Decided on doing something and stuck to it right until the end. I'm going to squash you and sit on top of you. Oh, it is lovely here. Well, that beautiful wind coming through again, and look at the lovely colors in the distance from the sunset with the lions. These are my favorite kind of afternoons, to be able to watch the light disappear, of course, in the background with the Nkuhumas in the foreground. Right, but we'll see if we can stick around with the Nkuhumas for a little bit longer. But let's go back across to Byron very quickly.
So we still don't have any updates. Having a look around, no luck just yet. VM and I were just talking, we were saying it's a tricky time of the evening this, because it's not quite dark enough that all the nocturnal animals are coming out yet. So it's a bit harder with the spotlight also, because the spotlight's not bright enough to really see in the distance. But it's now getting to that time where it's a little bit better. So maybe we have some luck. See, I'm looking very carefully in the trees and all over, just for any sign of something small, something interesting. There's some impala around here. Don't want to shine on them too much. Their eyes are very sensitive. But it's been a wonderful afternoon. We've seen some really interesting things. Some birds, different antelope, and a lot of elephant, which has been great. It's been wonderful spending time with those elephant. I really enjoyed that. They were everywhere today. Sorry, impala. There's another impala off to the side. Hoping to maybe even just spot an owl somewhere in these trees. The last time I was here in June, managed to find a number of giant eagle owls. I haven't heard any yet, but I'm going to carry on listening out for them. Maybe we're fortunate and we still find one in the next few weeks. Again, my multitasking is being put to the test, trying to shine the spotlights, look for animals and drive and stay on the road and chat to the camera. Gonna be a pro at this by the end of the safari live stint. It doesn't look like we've had any luck so far. I think we're going to say goodnight. It's been a wonderful afternoon with you. Hope you've enjoyed your sunset drive with us. VM, thank you and goodbye to VM on camera for me this afternoon. It was great having him with us. Thank you to the ladies in the FC. Thank you to all the viewers and for all your questions again and your comments. We love having them. Have a great evening. And Taylor's going to say goodbye now. We'll see you tomorrow morning. Good night.
Look at those stunning colors that I was telling you about just a moment ago. The sun is now set beyond the horizon. Isn't that lovely? Elizabeth, I'm glad you think that the sky is beautiful. It almost looks like it was on fire. It was so stunning. Now, we've got two of the cubs who have come through to get groomed. Oh, I can see some trouble. I'm going to try and angle this little light a little bit better. Can we have a look over there? I'm going to duck very quickly. Look at what's going on here. Little cub, and I know it's an awkward angle. I apologize. I just can't move. They're a bit close to me. Ooh, big growls, turn your volume up. This male is not becoming very tolerant. Big yawn and back to sleep again. Not even the tail teasing that this cub did could get that male to carry on with his day. Although he sat back up again. Oh, and he's running after them. Let's see why he's running. Oh, trying to get a
Ooh, I'm putting a little bit of a, I'm actually using my torch at the moment because it's not as harsh as the other light. See how he ran over there? Perhaps she's still in estrus. Maybe she's coming out of it. And that's why he is hot on her heels. Now, of course, I think there's going to be a little bit of aggression shown towards the cubs if they get too close. I'm going to try avoid shining directly on the cubs. Like I said, my torch is not very strong though. Even when I shine it in my eyes, it's okay. Not that I'd like to do that though. He's going to sit down and sit nice and close. Off he goes. I'm going to very quickly turn the lights back around again. Have another look. One's got distracted, not really bothered by the kill at all, but instead has found a stick to play with. Here we go, having a little munch. Oh, there we go, that's nice. You bite Mom's neck. Mom is just trying to groom you. Now, I'm so sad to say this, but unfortunately, my time here with all of you is almost up. We've just got a couple of seconds left of the show, but I hope you've enjoyed it. Thank you so much to everybody who was involved to put together this amazing afternoon. But myself and David will see you tomorrow for the Sunrise Safari. Good night.